you via Podcast Nation Network. APN. Technology, news, and information. All in one place.
This is the E911 Talk Podcast, episode 95, for Monday, July 30th, 2012.
Welcome to this edition of E911 Talk with your host, Mark Fletcher, product line manager for emergency services at Avaya. Now, here's Fletch.
It was a warm, sunny day in beautiful Nashville, Tennessee this past Thursday, where MLTS E911 took another significant step forward as the Tennessee Emergency Communications Board hosted an informative session on the topic that has been gaining traction in several states as well as the federal level. In fact, the Federal Communications Commission issued a notice of inquiry specifically targeting the location reporting capabilities in an MLTS or PBX when users dial 911. Now, one of the things that I find fascinating is that in addition to the normal stories that always find their way into each one of these sessions, such as the Gaithersburg, Maryland individual who suffered a heart attack at his desk, only to be found 10 hours later after first responders could not locate him upon their initial response, there always seems to be a whole new series of stories, many of them told by public safety administrators. These additional stories, often local, describe other near disasters that involve location confusion from MLTS users. In fact, many call takers say that these types of calls are actually quite common. Yet many go undocumented as public safety call takers constantly go above and beyond their normal responsibilities to do whatever it takes to get help to the people on the other side of the phone. I firmly believe that the main reason we never hear about these issues is solely to the dedication the call takers give to doing their jobs well. Lynn Questel, Executive Director of the Tennessee Emergency Communications Board, opened the meeting with a story from May of this year. Apparently, a security guard was forced to use his cell phone to call 911 after several tries from the PBX telephone failed to complete. Later, it was found that the PBX MLTS was programmed to require 9 for an outside line and then 911 to complete the call. Additionally, the system did not have 911 programmed with any priority, a specific situation that is called out in the NINA MLTS model legislation technical information document. Other examples of 911 calls reaching the PSAP, but providing the dispatchers only the billing location and not the physical location of the caller, were provided by other members of the TECB. An alarming figure that was also provided was an example of how widespread the problem was. Based on her estimation, nearly one half of the citizens were serviced by PBX and MLTS systems and were potentially affected by this problem. Now, as in just about any discussion of E911 today, next-generation 911 came up several times, as did the statewide 911 emergency network. Tennessee has been very proactive, and the status of the State of Tennessee Emergency Services IP Network, or ESINet, were discussed. This IP-based emergency call delivery solution is one of the first statewide emergency services IP networks in the country. Leveraging IP as the underlying transport, the Tennessee ESINet will also be able to provide 911 services with additional redundancy and features that do not exist in today's analog-based 911 platforms. Now, in addition to doing its homework and building a NINA I3-compliant next-gen 911 infrastructure, plans are already being established to move the Annie Alley database into the ESINet, where access to entities with entries in the database will be provided free of charge. Now, this certainly caught my attention and has to be one of the more forward-thinking approaches that I've ever seen in any other state. From an enterprise perspective, one of the more complex challenges is managing the Annie Alley database information for users behind the MLTS PBX. Now, while next-generation 911 doesn't eliminate the use of Annie Alley, it certainly provides the underlying infrastructure for the originating device to actually send its information along with the call, eliminating the need for Annie Alley information. Now, personally, I think this is one of the more confusing points about next-generation 911. One way to look at it is like rotary dial telephones. Sure, in many cases, you can still use them on the network today, but why would you want to send electromechanical pulses down the line only to be interpreted as digits when you can just send the digit itself? Now, does that make the rotary telephone incompatible with today's networks? Well, not really, but its use will be limited, especially when you hit a menu of options for an IVR or an auto attendant menu. Having a new network in place that will handle multimedia sessions from the public in a NINA i3 compliant architecture is an excellent first step. Although this does not address how the information gets into the database or how it's maintained, it does provide a place to hold the data, and that eliminates any storage or usage charges for the enterprise customer that they're encumbered with on today's legacy network. So overall, this ends up being a very positive step towards the deployment of next generation 911 in the volunteer state, and is going to provide a very aggressive architecture for MLTS PBX administrators to attach to. So should we expect MLTS legislation in Tennessee right away? Well, I think that would be a little presumptuous to answer at this point in time. What I can tell you is that the Tennessee Emergency Communications Board is well aware of the problem, as well as the benefits providing the correct information from an MLTS user. The technical and policy committees are well versed on next generation 911, as well as potential contributions of additional data from originating networks, including both cellular and enterprise. Given their proactive approach as seen in the construction of their statewide network to date, I would expect nothing other than a good example for its proper use in providing detailed information to first responders. And this is certainly one state to keep a close eye on.
You've been listening to the E911 Talk Podcast with your host, Mark Fletcher, Product Line Manager for Emergency Services at Avaya. E911 Talk is a weekly podcast available on sites like this, as well as iTunes, and is available free of charge. If you have any comments or questions, you can email Fletch at FletcherM@Avaya.com. That's Fletcher, the letter M, at Avaya.com. Be sure to listen in next week for more informative topics on E911.
911, the line is recorded. What is the exact location of your emergency?
This is the Avaya Podcast Nation Network, APN.